mainly I work on hypervisor like Xen, Hyper-V, sometimes on beam graphics. So the idea of this talk was by last year's KVM forum talk by Jim Maxson from Google. In his talk, Jim, is he here in the room? No, okay, so I think whatever I want, well, he's so he was talking about nesting KVM on KVM. And while this is really important and interesting, in his talk he was mainly describing which optimizations we can do for KVM as level zero hypervisor. And when we run other hypervisors being nested, we don't have such options, especially when we run something proprietary and evil like Hyper-V. But can we still do something in Linux to be a good guess? And actually, are we a good level one hypervisor or not? So this is basically the idea of this talk. So now the setup. So what's the setup I'm going to be talking about in this talk? So basically, we have Hyper-V installed on their hardware. And as you know, Hyper-V is like Microsoft proprietary hypervisor. It's a type 0 hypervisor, top 1 hypervisor, which is split between the hypervisor itself and the management partition. And management partition for Hyper-V is always needed for now, but who knows? Right? So what we're going to do is we'll be running a Linux in the VM. But inside this, we will run KVM and we'll try to run level 0 guests. Only Linux for now, so I haven't tried Windows, so though it's kind of possible. Why is it important and why would you actually like care, why would you want to try that? Well, there is no single answer for that, but my answer would be that it's mainly because of Azure and some other like private deployment of Hyper-V. So it may happen to you that your customer, for example, is moving to Asia, right? And you have no choice. So you have to move your like workload or containers or whatever you run to this hypervisor. Because of some non-technical reasons sometimes, like price of goods on Asia, for example. Yeah, so what you can do with this second level virtual machine? Well, first you can try splitting big instances into chunks. For example, like M128 instance in Azure, if you know, it has like 128 CPUs, 4 terabytes of memory. That's a pretty big instance. So sometimes you may want to actually divide it into several parts and use them separately. You may be interested in running secure containers. Stuff like Intel Player containers, Kata containers, Huge Beer, which you just heard about from Fabian. So you may actually want to run virtual machines there on this cloud. And for that, you definitely need this virtualization there. So as well, you can just want to move the whole workload that you have or do some testing and debugging there. It's also possible. So, nesting in Hyper-V. It's relatively new. They only added it in 2016. And they were mainly targeting running Hyper-V on Hyper-V. Why did they do that? So, at least what they told me is that their main driver was because in this 2016 family of this Windows as proprietary evil, they added some security features which are virtualization based. And if you want to use this feature and you are running a virtual machine, that means that you will be running nesting. So if you have just like a single like, Windows setup, Windows 10, Windows 2016, nesting is not enabled there by default. You will run a virtual machine and KVM won't load there. It will tell you, sorry, no hardware support for that. There's no like Linux extension for that. So you have to enable it. And after you do that, it only starts working. At least that's the expectation. So you can run KVM there, you can create virtual machine there. You can basically do whatever you need nowadays with KVM and the whole stack on bare hardware. So great, right? Are we done? Well, using it for testing purposes, we may be interested in how well it actually performs, right? Especially if you want to run like a campaigner, we don't want to have significantly lower performance of the campaigner compared to like level one. So what I was interested in when I started working on this like several months ago was like, okay, cool, it works, but does it really perform? So I started doing several benchmarks, trying to look at various aspects of such nesting. And the thing is really that every particular workload requires taken care of, because different workloads have different implications when you run them in virtualized environments in the first place, but in nesting, even more complicated. So, first example, I hope you can see there, is like a classical example of how you test your virtualization in general. I will try to explain later why, but this example is a simple thing. It's just a type CPU ID loop. I hope that everybody in this room knows that, but like RDTSC returns this like cycle count from your CPU. It's just a counter. It's like a single assembly instruction. You run it, you get the counter. CPU ID is another instruction which, like this particular one, returns this like main CPU features, I guess. And we try to see how fast this works, right? For a simple loop. So, the results. If you run this from bare metal, something like Skylake processor, you will get like 180 cycles. Level 1, and here level 1 I mean you run Linux on Hyper-V, not Linux on KVM. You will get like 1,350 cycles. With KVM it's very, very similar. I got like 1,200 even, like less than this number. But if you run a virtualized guest on Hyper-V, you will see something like that. That's kind of a lot. I mean, more cycles is spent on each instruction, worse the performance, right? So, is it bad? It is. But can we make it better, actually? Right? Why is it bad? And for that, to actually like understand that, you need to know how virtualization on Intel works in general. And I'm sorry, I will only be talking about like Intel virtualization today. AMD is somewhat similar. With ARM, it's like significantly different, so I won't be getting into that. We don't have Hyper-V for ARM publicly released yet. So, with all that, Microsoft claims that they have it internally, they run it internally, but nobody outside of Microsoft code, and I didn't see it either. So, how does virtualization work on Intel? So your hypervisor, it's like general, it doesn't matter if it's like KVM or Hyper-V, any hypervisor on x86 will do the same. So you prepare a special area which describes your guest, and there is like one page of memory, 4 kilobytes. And this is like a special area in memory, but which you cannot like edit directly, you need to like use special instructions to access. And you describe your guest, where is the starting point, like what are different things, like all these x86 features you have. And when you create this memory, it describes your guest, you basically run it. And after that, your guest runs on CPU uninterrupted. You don't do anything from the hypervisor. So the hypervisor is not involved in that case. It's only when your guest will do something special which requires some attention from the hypervisor, which cannot be done. You will turn back into the hypervisor. Hypervisor is supposed to handle the trap and resume the guest. And that's how it works. Like, we wait till the trap, we handle, we resume. With like several guests, we sometimes like schedule them in. It's like a little bit more complicated, but in a nutshell, it's like that. So this is like the first level of virtualization, very simple. Okay, so how do you think nested virtualization works? If you didn't know anything about it, if you haven't read in those manual, you may think that level one hypervisor just does the same, right? It prepares this area for its level two guest and it runs it. And when something is happening in level two guest, we will jump into level one hypervisor, right? Handle the call, resume level two, and continue executing. But it's not how it is. From level one hypervisor's point of view, and yeah, really, speaking about nesting, it's a really bit confusing, and I can even confuse myself saying this level one, level two, it's really not easy. I'm sorry. So, how does it work? So, level one hypervisor thinks that it's basically like the only hypervisor in the system. So, it prepares the area. But when it runs the area, it cannot be run. It first needs to merge with the idea of what level zero hypervisor thinks about level one hypervisor. Because like level one hypervisor may already have some restrictions. And we cannot prepare a guest which will have less restrictions, right? So we need to merge these two ideas. So when we run, we actually go to level one hypervisor. Level one hypervisor analyzes the state which we just created, merges it with his ideas of how it needs to be run, and then it runs it in parallel to level one hypervisor. So it's not really on top of level one, it's actually like in parallel. And what the interesting thing here is what happens when we trap. Like, we execute this CPID instruction, right? CPID instructions by Intel manual, they're always trapped. We get Intel at level zero first. That's the only real hypervisor in the system. And level zero looks at the exit, like, oh, the exit is probably not for me, or I'm not going to handle it. So you can pass execution flow to level one hypervisor. And level one hypervisor will think, oh, our level two guest just trapped. But it's not like that. It didn't just trap. It's like the execution flow is coming from level zero. And it's a little bit slower, of course. Especially when level one hypervisor tries to like edit the state, it tries to do this special command like beam read, beam write, you're familiar with them probably. And by default, all these commands trap into level zero hypervisor. So Intel came with a feature like 3 years ago, which is called like shadow VCS. So level one zero hypervisor can actually load like especially this special area for level one hypervisor, which won't be executed, but level one can access it directly. So no beam access. And maybe pretty fast. But still, when we try to run our level two, we still need to tap into level zero. Level zero needs to analyze all the state, merge it with this idea, and run level two. And that's how it works in Intel. So back to our question, can we make it better? Well, we cannot make it as good as level exit from level one because of these architectural limitations. We will always be trapping into level zero. Level zero will always be performing some work for us, then merging these ideas and resuming the guest, and each beam exit will cost us significantly more than what it costs us on level one. But we can still do better, and Microsoft talks in their specs, they have publicly available spec. You can download it. It's like PDF which describes all the features I'm talking about. So they created a feature called like enlightened VMCS. It feature means that level zero with level one will communicate through a well-defined structure in memory. So level one suddenly becomes aware, oh, I'm running nested. So I can try to help level zero hypervisor. I will try to tell it what I actually changed in the structure. So we don't need to actually analyze the call state, because if level one was taking to something in the structure which we have no access to, we don't know, right? So they created this like PB protocol for the interaction. And the PB protocol is significantly faster. So yeah, there is actually on the mailing list. It's still in works. But I would expect it to get merged into 4.17, like not this terminal, but the next one. Because this merge window is already open and we are still working on this one. So, the result. Well, we go down to somewhat less than 9,000. And if you remember what I showed you, we had like 20,000 before. So this is actually a significant speed up. It's looking good. So, next benchmark. So that was the benchmark for CPU aging. Let's try doing one simple thing. Let's write the type officially, trying to figure out what's the time right now, right? And while it may seem very synthetic, right, like who would do that in his program, it actually is being used. If you have like an Apache server running and it's trying to output something to its logs, it will try to timestamp each entry in the log. So it needs to get the timestamp. So it will actually be doing something very, very similar to that, reading the time from the system. So, simple use case, let's try to see how well it performs. Okay, again, bare metal, 55 cycles, so it's pretty fast. You run it, you get instantly. In level 0 or level 1, it's not significantly different, 55 or 70 CPU cycles, it's nearly the same, but in level 2 you will get something like this. And this is post this spectrum meltdown thesis. Before that we had 600. So that's the effect. I have to redo this test for this talk multiple times because kernel was changing so fast that I didn't want to show you this stale number. Like I had 300 sitting here like a month ago. But then I just said, like, what's the point in showing you 200? So, it's 1,500. Well, that's not going to perform well, you may guess. And you're correct. So, what next? I mean, it doesn't perform, and we need to figure out why. You may have a valid idea that something with our clock source is wrong, right? We probably have a better one somewhere. So what do we have? If you check on level 1, we get like a so-called like TST page clock source from Hyper-V. And on level 2, we get KVM clock. And if you go read the guidelines, like how do I tune my system to perform on hypervisors, you will see that these are actually good clock sources for both of them. So for Hyper-V, it will be said that use Hyper-V clock source TST page. For KVM clock, they will tell you, KVM clock is probably what you want to use on KVM. And they both perform very well, usually. But for some reason, they don't perform very well here. Why? Well, at this point, you have to use some tools like Perf to figure out why, or even go and read the code. So, I did. And turns out that currently KVM only treats TST clock source as a valid clock source to make its guest clock source stable. Well, what does it mean? It means that in case you do something different from TST in your host virtualization host, which is L1 in our case, stable clock source won't get passed to your level 2 guest. And then comes the difference. When the clock source is not stable, you cannot use VDSO method in kernel. And VDSO means that you are not doing a syscall. You're not doing a syscall, your agent is mostly negative. And that explains these like 70 cycles which you get. If you do a syscall, you get what you get. And post spectrum when you have to actually switch to each table on that. 1,500 is no surprise. So can we actually like teach KVM and tell it that hyperreport source in the TST page is like a very good clock source? Well, yes we can. And we do that, simple patch, it all starts working very well. I will show you the numbers later. But we get an issue. Imagine you want to migrate your level 1 with all its level 2 guests inside. And you migrate. So what happens? CPU which has different TSC frequency. So that CPU with different frequency. Okay, you can do that. And what will happen? What is this TSC page clock source and why do we need it? The TSC page clock source is basically just a shared memory page with CPU interface, which tells us that when we read TSC from the hardware, we need to multiply it and add some offset. So we can actually basically like scale it and add some offset to it. So when we actually migrate, the hypervisor will update this page for us. And when we read it next time, the reading will be correct still. So we won't see a jump. We won't see it like speeding up or slowing down. We will still be the same clock source we saw before, and that's what we actually need in Linux. Because if we ever like go down, your user space will go back, your user space will definitely behave. If your frequency will change, then you may measure time your program is incorrectly. So we actually need that. And this happens. Hypervisor does that automatically for us. No need to worry. But what happens to level 2 guests? In level 2 guests, we have more or less the same protocol, which is called like PV clock or KVM clock source, if you look from the clock source side, which is supposed to do the same. Like when we migrate guests which are on KVM, KVM will update values there, so the reading will still be correct. But nobody actually told KVM that we just migrated. Because it's not a virtualized guest, so it's not aware of migrations. We need to somehow tell it that please stop your guest and go update all the stages before you are able to execute them again. So their readings will still be correct. And we need to do this exactly when we migrate. So can we do that? Yes, we can. In the spec, you can find so-called reenlightenment feature, where things work. So you can ask your hypervisor, hyper-V, to send you an interrupt when you migrate. And you can ask it to emulate all TSC access before you manage to update all the stages. And we did that. And after that, these are the numbers we get. So, as you can see, this issue here goes away completely. So, such workloads will run in level 2 with exactly the same speed as, basically exactly the same speed that they're running in level 1. So there are not any worse. Okay, so these were some micro benchmarks and some synthetic tests you may think, but how does it affect real workloads and shall you actually use it nowadays, shall we wait till it gets merged into the kernel? Well, so I took basically two bigger workloads and to do my measurement. And the first one was IPROF. If you know that IPROF is like a performance benchmark for networking, it uses like big packets, so it's not something like NFV with like small packets, not something like SDK. So we just take the whole channel and we are trying to like saturate it all. We can send like traffic to parallel and we look how well it performs. So the hardware setup is somewhat important here. But like pretty powerful, we have like 40G network card, our server with two nodes. And it's like well enough to connect X3 card, we can actually do SRIOV. SRIOV in Hyper-V is kind of special because it only supports a few network cards nowadays. So it's like with Mellanox, some Intel, and I think that's it. So, but I was lucky to find one which is actually supported. And when we run our level 2 guest, I was running like vanilla Fedora kernel after the with this meltdown factor fixes unnotified. And The question is, how do we connect level 2 network to the real network? And with Hyper-V, we don't actually have many options, because even with virtual functions, we can do some sort of a bridging there, because we can't have more than one address there initially. So we can't put it in like permission mode, like PF in level 0 won't allow us to. So I was doing what like Libvirt does by default. It creates like vehicles. The only thing I changed was I changed the number of using vehicles to make it like two. And using that constant device. So, okay, we have like big guess for level 1, we have like one human node for level 2, and we will run Hyper. So, how well does it perform? Yes. So, these are the numbers. As you know, if you run it in level 1, you need like 4 parallel streams to saturate this 40 gigabit network card. With level 2, it's worse, but it's not like in these synthetic examples when we're 10 times slower, right? So, especially when we add this 11 VLCS support, we're basically able to saturate the network adapter 2. We only need like more streams. And it gives us an advantage compared to using like normal VLCS and pretending we don't know anything about Hyper-V under us. But as you can see, the difference is not that big. So for this real Hyper-V benchmark, we're actually doing good even today. So you can go ahead and try using it. And what you can actually play with how to tune this setup. I'm not going to pretend that that was like the perfect setup. You can probably make it better, of course. So you can use like CPU pinning in L2, especially, or in L1, especially if you have like multiple neural nodes. So you may make your level 2 guess nowhere aware, or you may pin it to a single neural node, and that's what I did. Like, to 8 to 2016 and pin them on one human node. You have multiple settings to play with in VHost, and there are like multiple presentations and talks and everything on how to do it properly. I'm definitely not an expert. I played with them a little bit and turned out that like with 2 queues we get the best result. Not sure why. And you can actually like tune your card well, but like I found out that like Nautilus is doing a great job by default. It will create as many queues as we have CPUs in one human node and will pin them accordingly by default. So I didn't have to do any changes there. Okay, so another great part is going to be almost the same, but just in case you're not that lucky and you won't find the network card which you can use a thorough DBs in Hyper-V, you have to use emulated device, so-called the VMBus or NetVSC you may be familiar with. And other than that, the setup is like exactly the same. So I just like turned that thorough DB off and tried to see the difference. And you will see something like that. So yeah, with level 1, instead of like 4, you have to use like 5 streams, but we can still saturate this device easily. With level 2, it becomes more complicated, and we're actually worse. We're only like reaching 30 gigabits. And our enlightened PMCS doesn't actually help us a lot, as you can see. So why does it happen? Well, it's probably because we have too many copies of the same data. L2 uses vHost and uses this virtual app and copies it to the host. The host copies it to VMBus Ring. VMBus Ring is being absorbed by Windows, which takes the packet and copies it to the real queue of the network card. So we are not able to reach doing stuff like CPU pinning and recode stacking, but we have one additional complication. If you use hyper-V emulated devices in kernel nowadays, they use like VM bus. And instead of real like interrupts, they use so-called channels. And these channels, they are being distributed automatically. Unlike an IRQ, which you can do something like run an IRQ balancer and it'll try to put them on different CPUs. This thing will, the kernel driver will kind of distribute them randomly and it will stay like that. You cannot change the assignment. So what you can do, you can try like pinning your guest to like different CPUs, for example. Which is not really like a practical advice, because next time you boot, you may get a different distribution here. Which you can only observe. So, and in Hyper-V, there is no way to reassign channels. There is no such API. So we cannot make it supported in the kernel for now. Maybe like Microsoft calls to see that and give us an option for that, but so far we are not aware of it. At least it's not in the public spec. What you can play is you can try changing the number of channels on this network adapter. It's like a side effect of this change. The network adapter goes away and comes back, and you will have a different distribution. So if you don't like it, just change the number of channels, you will get more likely with that. That's like a hackish approach to it. Okay, so, yes. So the last benchmark I did was a kernel view. That's so-called like a bench, but I wasn't running this itself, I just did the build. And to compare like apples with apples, I had to like reboot my level 1 into the same kernel as L2 was running. So when it was not running level 2, it was running stock Fedora kernel. When it was running L2, I was doing tests on like RCA plus my delighted PMCS and this code source. So what do we do? We just build kernel in like 8 streams, do some all yes config and yes. And we build the kernel. So how well does it perform? You know, if you try, you will see something like that. As you can see, the numbers are very close, actually. And our analysis being said don't even help in this case. Actually make things a bit worse. So why is that? Well, the answer is that when you run such workload, which is CPU intensive, we don't do many VMAs, as I explained to you in the beginning. We are basically sitting on the same CPU and doing some like computations. So as we expect, the speed is the same. Right, they are still on the same CPU with the same instruction set. And you don't actually need to optimize anything if your workload is only like CPU intensive. Oh yeah, I have to mention that I was running this on in memory, so no real hard drive was used, so the kernel was built on KVM. So, if you mine Bitcoin, it doesn't really matter where. If you use your CPU for mining Bitcoin, why would you do that? You can do it in level 2 equally good or equally bad in level 1. So, what else? What's left if you read the stuff? We have a couple more features which we are not implementing in Linux yet. And first is Enlightened MSR bitmap. And it's a thing where you can tell level 0 hypervisor, but I should probably describe it like that, but when you run the virtualized guest, you can create a page with all these bits for all MSRs. MSR is like model specific register in the CPU. You read it and you get some result. And you can actually tell the CPU when you want to have the VMX, when your guest reads this MSR, or when it writes to this MSR. And you have like a memory page. And again, the problem is exactly the same we had with like normal VNCS. That when our level one hypervisor edits the structure, we don't really know what was changed there. So we have to go through the whole page and check all the bits in this page to see if something was changed. Maybe nothing even was changed in there, but we don't know. So they again introduce a protocol that when you can tell your hypervisor, your level zero hypervisor, meaning hyper-V, when you can tell it if something was actually changed in this page, and it really needs to examine it before it resumes executing your guess. And it's supposed to fit things up a little bit, but we don't have this yet. The other interesting thing is the DBT will be flat. And it's interesting even without this L2 guess. As you may know that we sometimes need to flush TOD, for example. Right now we switch from like kernel pages to user space pages or in the other direction, and we sometimes want to flush TOD so we won't get stale entries there. And how is it done in x86? In x86, we have no single command. Just invalidate TOD on all CPUs you have. If you want to invalidate your TOD on other CPUs, you have to send an interrupt there, basically like an IPI. The processor will catch the IPI and invalidate its own TOD. So, virtualized guests can do exactly the same. They can send IPIs to other virtual CPUs and they will execute and flush their buffer. But the problem is that some of their CPUs may not be scheduled at this point. Some other guests may be running there. So we send an interrupt there and it's pending. Because the CPU is not executed, like we will execute it later. Moreover, the CPU which actually sends these APIs, it's waiting for the job to be done. So it all becomes significantly slower when you have an overcommitted guest, when you have more than one CPU per physical CPU. So KVM folks, they came up with a PV protocol, that's their solution to all issues, came up with a PV protocol when hardware doesn't perform. And they introduced a code that PVTLB flush. You're basically executing a hypercall instead of sending RPIs to all CPUs, and your hypervisor will see if it's some different CPU which sits there, not from your guest. You don't even need to invalidate TLB there, because the side effect of switching VCPUs there is the TLB flush. So basically it does nothing for the CPUs. And on CPUs which are actually scheduled, actually does the TLB flush. And we, like this year, several kernel releases ago, I forgot the number, we add the support for this protocol in Linux. So when you run Linux on Hyper-V, you can benefit from this TLB flush protocol. But the feature they have, and which I listed here, is that they have direct flush for level 2 guests. Because when you're running nested, the probability that your virtual CPU is actually being executed at this time is even lower than with V1, right? You may have several level 1 guests, and then each level 1 may have several level 2 guests, so they just get a tiny, tiny portion of real CPU. And they provide an option to do this TLB flush directly from L2 guests. They will just go into level 0. Level 0 will examine which virtual CPUs of these guests are currently scheduled and do TLB flush accordingly. So this is also supposed to bring some performance improvement, on the virtualized L2 guests. But work hasn't started yet. So if you're interested, join. Or if I'll try to get to sooner or later. And that's it, guys. So if you have any questions, and the answer is that they have certain instance types which support it and certain which don't. Azure is made of different hybrid versions. So if you look at it, that new instance types which run in 2016, they have it in Azure. So I know for sure that this is the biggest M128 supports it. I think that the instances version 3 support that, and maybe E version 3, something like that. I'm not sure, but certain instance types support that. Yeah, so drop me an email, I have this somewhere written. I asked Microsoft directly and I have a reply to this question. But you may just try. KVM module load, just like module load KVM tab. If it doesn't tell you that, oh, no hardware support, then it support. If it does tell you that, sorry, it's not support, then you have to try another instance type. You have no pressure, enable or disable. They will do it on their own for you. Another question? Yeah.
Please.
The question was how does it compare with running KVM on KVM? And the answer is that when we implement these KVM features like Lightning GMCS, we perform significantly better than KVM on KVM. KVM on KVM runs faster. In particular, Paolo told me that before Spectrum meltdown, he was able to reach something like 13,000 CPU cycles on nested VMX. That was like the best setup he had. With my series, I saw 7,500, so like half. We have a huge room for optimization inside KVM being level 0 hypervisor. And we may actually think about bringing this feature to KVM one way or another. Yeah, so I saw a question about, sorry, the time is up, so just approach me and I will answer. So stay together.